and Art Heidebrecht. It's my great pleasure to extend a warm welcome to all of you for our 33rd annual John Hodgins Memorial Lecture. The lecture series was established in 1983 as a memorial to Dr. John W. Hodgins, who was McMaster's first Dean of Engineering. Each year, we invite a prominent guest to join us, and they share their insights into how technological and scientific advancements are reshaping our society and our humanism. Over the past 60 years since the founding of McMaster Engineering, our school has continued through a trajectory that embraces these ideas: science, technology, society, and humanism. We inspire engaged citizen scholars to transform the world, and we continue to involve our educational programs in this vein. We have a long history of innovative educational programming and have produced exceptional alumni. They're a force for positive change around the globe. As part of the world's top 100 universities, McMaster Engineering is leading positive change to produce a brighter world. Our own rankings reflect our efforts in recruiting the best students and maintaining a lower rate of attrition of our undergraduate students than any other university in Canada. We have a rich history of research that addresses the grand challenges facing Canada and the world, including climate change, renewable energy, digital transformation, and healthcare. Since the founding of our faculty by John Hodgins, McMaster Engineering has committed itself to leading research and world-class education with a social conscience. So where does that take us? That brings me to the introduction of our guest speaker, Dr. Geordie Rose. Geordie graduated from McMaster University in 1994 with a Bachelor of Engineering in Engineering Physics. Thereafter, he earned his PhD in physics from the University of British Columbia. While studying at McMaster, Geordie was a member of the 1994 McMaster National Champion Wrestling Team, and he's a member of the McMaster Hall of Fame. In 2010, he was the Naga World Champion in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in both the gi and the non-gi categories. He's an elite power lifter. Why is he here? He's here because he's also a serial entrepreneur. Geordie founded his first enterprise, D-Wave, which was the world's first quantum computing company. He founded Kindred, the world's first robotics company to use reinforcement learning in a production environment. And now he is founder and CEO at Sanctuary, which develops and creates synthetic human-like robots. Geordie was named the 2011 Canadian Innovator of the Year, and he was one of Foreign Policy Magazine's 100 leading global thinkers of 2013. For a short time, he also held the Guinness Book of World Records world record for the most yogurt eaten in 1 minute. So, with all these accomplishments, I hope he has something enlightening and amusing to say to us today. Please join me in welcoming Geordie Rose as he presents how human-like robots will impact work, life, and society. Geordie?
Thanks.
Welcome.
Hey, everybody. Yeah, the yogurt one is the one that I'm most proud of. You might have guessed. And I can tell you a little bit about it later if you'd like after the lecture. So my name is Geordie. I'm going to be delivering the lecture, but this is as much about one of my work colleagues, Nadine, as it is about me. So you're going to see Nadine throughout the presentation. We're going to talk about her and what she represents or what we hope that she could be. Nadine is a new category of thing that doesn't exist or hasn't existed before, which we think of as synthetic humans, or abbreviation being synth. So a synthetic human, in the way that we think about them, are machines that with increasingly high fidelity mimic the human, not only in form, but also in function. So for example, being able to understand the world the same way we do, being able to navigate the world the same way we do, understand things the same way we do, have the same emotional spectrum, the same feelings of self. Every attribute that you label yourself with, every feeling that you have about who you are, we want to be able to create these kinds of things in machines. And of course, we can't do it yet, but as a North Star, it's what guides the work that I'm doing now. So the Nadine is just one robot, and the broad arc of the story I'm going to tell you is about transforming Vancouver into what you can think of as a sanctuary city for this new type of categorical thing. Now, the way to think about what we're trying to do with Vancouver is, say, in this room, if you look to your left and look to your right, I encourage you to do so. Look at the fellow humans in the room. What we want is for that experience to be such that in Vancouver, one of the two is a synth, no matter where you go. So millions of these machines living, working, being in Vancouver as a test bed for the beginnings of a new type of interaction between humans and technology. This is a big ambition, of course, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about how we got to this point. But because we're at McMaster, I wanted to start by telling you a little bit about how all this came to be, because that seems like a very interesting or crazy thing to be working on. So how did I get here? The first thing I wanted to point out is that, you know, universities aren't all about learning facts and being able to do problems in the back of textbooks. They're about people and learning how to interact with them. And the reason I came to Mac had nothing to do with school. It had to do with wrestling. So when I was in high school, my whole life was dedicated to this sport. And when I went to university, I wanted to go to a program that was good. And in Canada at the time, there were two. One was Simon Fraser and one was McMaster. And McMaster was closer to where my parents were. So that's where I wanted to go. But there was a problem. My grades weren't good enough to get into residence. So I was good enough to get into the engineering program, but not good enough to get into residence. And I was 15 at the time, and my parents wouldn't let me leave home unless I got into residence. And this guy, Nick, who is the wrestling coach at the time and still is now, did something to get me into residence. So I'm not sure exactly what he did. But I'm thankful to him, because nothing that I'm about to tell you would have happened if that man hadn't performed that act of kindness at that point. He didn't have to do that. He did. Got me into school, and all that happened later was derived from that. In 1994, I was lucky enough to be part of a group that won the national championships. That's me on your left with hair. You might not recognize me back then. With a couple of my good friends who still to this day are some of my best friends. Of course, I didn't just do sports. I actually did go to school and take courses and stuff. But I was in engineering physics, and my path through life eventually went into physics after. And Catherine was the most important person in diverting me from the path that I was on into the physics world. She was kind enough to take me on as a physics NSERC summer student for 3 summers, and I learned a lot about how to do physics with Catherine. So I'm very grateful to her for her guidance and eventually helping me to get into UBC. When I applied to grad school, I again got turned down by every single school except UBC, and I think that the only reason UBC took me was Catherine, because Catherine was kind of a superstar, still is, in condensed matter theory, and talked to some of the folks there and said, give this guy a chance, and they let me in. So this is going to be a recurring theme through this, is that a lot of the things that have worked for me in my life don't have to do with marks or grades or performance of some easily measurable type. They have to do with relationships with people and building them. So I went to UBC, did a PhD, and right after that, because of the nature that I was work I was doing, it was natural to try to build this type of computer that D-Wave started building. D-Wave was founded on the premise of changing the world in a very specific way. So back in 1999, theoretical people had imagined that you could build computers that harnessed the properties of nature at a certain scale, which are very difficult to do. And these machines are called quantum computers, and they're very interesting, bizarre machines. So I thought, well, can't be that hard. Let's try to build one. And 15 years later, it's still not clear whether that's been successful. But, or at least, I guess it's now, it's almost 19 years. I left after 15 years. But the experience with D-Wave taught me an awful lot. But the reason it's relevant to this, the subject matter today, is that the last half of my tenure at D-Wave was spent working with our customers. And the customers bought these machines to try to use them to do AI. And at the time, I didn't know anything about AI, but I had to learn pretty quick. So my job was primarily the number two. I raised a lot of money, but the other thing was much more important, which was how to make this new kind of thing useful. And for me, that was all about connecting it to solving problems in artificial intelligence that the research community really cared about. So I had to learn a lot. And this guy was the very first person that I met that was a real AI researcher. He was one of the leading people in computer vision in the world. He'd founded and sold two companies that did computer vision kinds of stuff even before deep learning became a thing. And he led many of the most important projects at Google that involved vision, including being the founder of the somewhat ill-fated Google Glass project. But now he runs their quantum artificial intelligence lab, which is one of the most successful efforts to build a quantum computer anywhere in the world. And the genesis of that project was me and him sitting down for several years figuring out how to connect quantum computing to AI problems. So inside D-Wave, when I was doing this sort of stuff, I was not enough because we had lots of people we needed to talk to. So I built a small team around me. And the most powerful intellect of that group was Suzanne Gildert. So Suzanne is a PhD in experimental physics, who, like me, came to AI later in life. But she has a certain prodigy level talent in understanding how to build complex systems. So you may have met people like this in your lives, people that are so far along the spectrum in some particular talent that they don't appear to even be human. You know, the sorts of things that they think or understand are so far beyond where everybody else is that you just wonder, where did this person come from? Like Ed Witten in string theory. They're just people who are so far away from the norm that you think, I need to work with this person. So Suzanne had an idea for how to do a particular type of AI, which is sometimes called general intelligence. But I think a better way of thinking about it is the control system in the mind of an animal. So if you think of any animal at all, anything from insects to humans, invertebrate, vertebrate, it doesn't matter, even plants. There's a thing that controls their actions. So there's a bunch of perception comes in, and then they act, and they do something. So nobody really understands how that works. I mean, even for something as simple as a housefly. But she had an idea for how to go about building robots that were a little bit like houseflies, and maybe lizards, and maybe mice, and maybe someday people. And it started as being a back-of-the-napkin thing, but then, as obsessive as she is, she turned it into a full blueprint of how you do this. And I said, this is brilliant. You need to commercialize this. This needs to be a company. So she left D-Wave in 2014 and founded Kindred. So Kindred's big idea was to take Suzanne's ideas on how to control robots and build robotic control systems that were completely different than the way anybody had controlled robots before, giving them what are, in essence, minds, in the same kind of way that you'd think of a mind of an animal. Now, the robots that we were able to build are not like people at all, but they are a little bit like insects. They can learn in certain limited ways. They can get better at certain kinds of things. And the entire paradigm of how you think of them is a body and a mind, the body being the robot, the mind being the control system. And this company was very successful. It was a lot more successful in a lot shorter period of time than D-Wave was. If you buy something online that's a piece of clothing, there's a good chance that one of these machines has touched it somewhere in its journey to you. So this Kindred Sort, which was the product, became very successful very quickly. But the reason that Suzanne wanted to build what she wanted to build was not to make a lot of money and build robots that sorted underwear. It was to build machines like people. So underneath all of this really difficult science was a yearning to build a machine that was like us. Not just something that could learn to move things around, but something very much deep like us. And so she became very unhappy, as I did, about the way that the whole enterprise had gone, even though it was making a lot of money and everything was great and we had great investors and the team was working well. So what we decided to do was split it into two parts. And the second part, the part that I'm with, is Sanctuary. So Sanctuary used all of those ideas that she'd come up with, but applied them very specifically through a very specific kind of robot. The robot looks like a person. So for a lot of reasons, we think that building robots that look exactly like people makes a lot of sense, specifically if you're trying to solve the general intelligence problem of how do you build machines like people, which is the essence of general intelligence, is to try to replicate humans. There's lots of other ways to think about generality, but the one that really matters to us as people is to try to build machines that are like people. So we have been doing this for almost a year now, and unlike the other two roles where my job was to raise money and then make it useful, this one's a little different. Because if you can build a machine that's like a person, making money is not the problem, because you can completely transform the world's economy if you could do this. It would be the most important thing that had ever happened in many different dimensions, including economic. That's not the issue. The big issue for me is the implications for us as humans about developing this type of technology and trying to figure out a way to do it in a way that benefits us. So I think technology has a mind of its own. We build technology not just because we want to, but because we have to. There's some kind of a genetic imperative in us to explore, to learn, to nurture our children, to build things in our own image. These things aren't things we control. They're deep in us. And so the question is, can we harness these drives that we have to make the outcome better for us? And so a lot of what I'm thinking about now is, how do you do something like this and have it be a good outcome? All right, so most people who work in AI don't do this. The question arises, does this actually make sense? I mean, technically. So does it make sense to try to build AI in a human-like robot? I have a little video here I wanted to show you.
Thank you for coming. This is beautiful. I wanted to meet you for a really, really long time. And you know, being here with you in the Cayman Islands, I gotta say, is I'm feeling a little something. You can grab it later if you want.
Every time I see that, it makes me laugh. So, how many of you know about Sophia? Okay, maybe about half. So Sophia is, in some sense, a trailblazer in the world of trying to make robots like people. And Sophia is the brunt of an awful lot of animosity in the AI community. This little picture on the left, this is only, I think, funny if you're an AI person, but so somebody superimposed three of the leading AI researchers' faces on a picture, and the guy in the middle there is Yann LeCun, who runs AI at Facebook. And Yann does not like Sophia at all. He's always on Twitter bashing her. So there are lots of people who don't like this idea of building human-like robots. But I think that actually is, this attitude that people have is absolutely wrong. And I'm going to try to tell you why I think that. The first thing is that if you're building AI like that people have, which I'll call real AI or human-like intelligence, it's really hard to know what to do. So let's say I had an unlimited amount of money and an unlimited number of people. I had every smart person in the world, and somehow, like let's say one of you in the audience, you were in charge of that project. So you have unlimited wealth. Think of the Manhattan Project. What do you actually do? Like, what are the steps that you take to try to solve this problem? And that stymies people, because we don't know what intelligence is. All of the words that we associate with the sorts of things we want, sentience, consciousness, intelligence, even things that are a little bit closer to being defined like empathy, we kind of know what these things mean, but when you have to write down a number which says, how empathic is that speaker? I'm going to apply my formula to it. We don't have a thing like that, right? We don't have a function that returns a number when I put a thing in it that tells me what intelligence is. And that kills engineering, of course. You can't build something if you don't know what you're maximizing. You know, if I was to build one thing and then another thing, and I was asked the question, is this actually better than this? If I have no way to quantify what I'm trying to do, I don't know. I can't make progress. There's no gradient. So general intelligence suffers from this problem very greatly. It's that AI researchers don't know what to do. And there are lots of ideas about this, but the one that I think makes the most sense is all of these words that we kind of think we understand, let's throw them out. Let's not think about intelligence or any of that. What we're going to do instead is use a metric of similarity. So I'm going to build a machine, and we're going to measure, using some function, how close it is to me, say, specifically. So I build a machine, and it's 3 feet tall. And then I build a machine, and it's 4 feet tall. The question is that better? The answer is yes, because it's closer to me. Not because of any abstract notion of humanness or intelligence or anything. It's a very simple question. Is it closer to me? So the having a blueprint for success is necessary for engineering, and it's a really big problem in general intelligence. So this is what we do, is instead of asking the question, is it smarter, we ask the question, is it more like me? And if the answer is yes, we're making progress. And that allows you a gradient. So when you're doing something really difficult, you need to be able to make small changes and see small advances. If you're in a situation where you're up against a cliff, where you don't know how to get over the cliff, you're kind of stuck. You need a smooth gradient, and similarity is a metric like that. Now, one of the main objections to robots like people is that the most successful of them are actually operated by humans. This is why he was saying it was like Wizard of Oz AI. The way that our robots and all robots like this work is that one of the potential control mechanisms is a human in the loop. So imagine a robot that looks like person kind of running Skype. So I could be in Toronto, and I talk through a microphone, and my voice comes out of the robot's mouth, and it's in Moscow. So the person who stood next to the robot, it looks like the robot is talking and being, you know, as intelligent as I could be in this conversation. But the critic would say, that's not real, because there's a human doing it. Where is the AI? So that's this beginning part, which I've called tele-op phase. So in these complex machines, the first thing you do is you control them entirely with human in the loop, just like that Kindred thing I showed you is the same. At first, it's a human doing everything. But then what you notice is that in the course of a day, like say you guys, I encourage you to do this, it's very illuminating. Chart out during the day the number of hours you're doing things that you think you could actually automate. So for example, let's say you have to sit on a bus and just wait. So that bus ride takes you half an hour. You don't really need to be doing much. That's easy to automate, just do nothing. So a lot of our lives are like that. So this first takeoff, this fragmented AI phase, replaces some of the activities of the human pilots with what you could think of as narrow AI capabilities. Things that are easy to automate using conventional AI techniques. Or they might augment the human. So for example, one of the easiest things you can do is a robot's visual system can look at you and it can detect your emotional state. That's really simple and works quite well. Now let's say I'm a human pilot, Wizard of Oz-ing the robot. I could have an overlay that says this person is distressed or lying or otherwise some kind of useful information that I might not be able to tell, augmented from the machine. So this beginning part, the purple takeoff, are all of the things that people work on AI now, integrated into a package that consolidates them in human form. So everything that's ever been built in the history of AI, you can pack into one of these machines and give that capability to a human-like robot. So there's the form factor doesn't limit you in using these things. You can still use all of the techniques of modern AI. Now the real thing that we want, of course, is to transition over into this blue thing, the general intelligence phase, where instead of having a package of thousands of these little agents or a human in the loop, the thing takes over and is able to make decisions and navigate the world on its own like a person. Now, I think we could do this in 10 years. So So my bet is that we can have machines that are substantially similar to people in 10 years. And not everybody believes that, of course, and of course, you know, predicting the future is impossible usually, but in some ways you have to put a flag in the ground, and I think 10 years is reasonable. Another reason why human-like robots are a good idea for, at least for mimicking humans, is that I've mentioned teleoperation several times. The teleoperation is a superpower in helping robots learn. So when a robot is built, there are lots of things that it can do, and that's a problem. Because when you're learning, you have to explore the space of possibilities. And if there's too many possibilities and you just randomly explore them, you will never find anything useful. If you would imagine you were to move every single muscle in your body randomly, and you were to wait until you learned how to walk, it would take you like a billion years. You never do it. So teleoperation allows a human to provide guidance to the robot to move in a way that we find good. So in a human robot, you can do what's called analogous teleoperation, where you have a human in a suit. So when the human does this, the robot does that all over the internet. When I'm wearing a heads-up display that receives the video feed from the robot, if I move my head like this, the robot moves their head, and I'm tracking the cameras in the eyes. So if I was a robot, stood up on stage, and my teleoperating pilot did this, my robot would do that, and now I can look over there, and now I can look over there. If I wanted to pick something up from the table as a robot, my teleoperator would look down, look at the field of view, look up, look at their hand, move it over, feel the tactile sensors in the hand, close the hand on the object, and pick it up. So having something that's a human makes that a lot easier. Imagine I was trying to do that with an octopus robot. How would I swim if I was an octopus and you were a human controlling it? You don't know how an octopus swims. And in fact, I don't think your brain could do it, because you'd have to control many more degrees of freedom of a different type than you have evolved to do. So being analogous helps in training a lot. The economic argument is simple, is that if you can do this, you can do all human work. So if you think about this strictly from the perspective of market size, being able to do what I'm talking about is a product that assigning a market size to is a meaningless statement. Because it, unlike products that have conventionally been built that service a human need, where a human will pay money to another human to provide a service, what you're talking about is interrupting that process at its root and creating a new type of entity that can do work. So all of the economy of the world flows through work. If you have a machine that can do all human work, the way that our economy operates breaks down. Because in the short term, every job ad that there is on Monster, I can take my robot fleet and apply for every single job and get them all, because you only have to pay me 10% of what you have to pay a human. So in the short term, these things do all the jobs, but in the long term, it has to be something else, right? Because that's not sustainable. There has to be a new economic model. But at least in the short term, it's the biggest market that has ever been, because the world is made for people. Now, one of the things that I feel most strongly about, and part of the reason why I'm doing this at all, is that AI is a massively powerful tool. So what we're talking about is digging in and pulling out the thing that makes us uniquely human, understanding it well enough to be able to create machines that have it. Everything we do comes from that, all the good, all the bad. If you can understand it, you can augment it for good or for bad. And I fear, I'm a little cynical, I fear that it's a lot easier to break things than it is to build things. And because of that, it's going to be a lot easier to create weapons than it is going to be to create scientists out of AI. Embodied AI is an obviously good idea, and everybody is trying to do it now. But when you do embodied AI, you have to pick the embodiment. And this is the embodiment that some people prefer, weapons of war. Putting AI inside things whose only reason for being is to kill other humans. I think that's terrible, should be a war crime. And in our own work, my view is that if you want to pick an embodiment for a super intelligent entity that's going to end the best possible way for people, it should be something that's very much like us. We should try to create, in our own image, machines that share our values. And of course, this is fraught with perils as well, but just consider for a second whether you'd rather have this robot, so that's Suzanne on the left and one of the robots on the right, if you'd rather have your super intelligent AI be that or that. And it's a choice that we're making, right? Like, we're engineers and scientists. A lot of you are going to be entering the workforce soon. You're going to have choices about what you do. For me, this is what I want to do. I think it's much more likely that this will end well. So many, many leading thinkers say the same kinds of things, but I wanted to drill this point home, is that, you know, AI of this sort is the most important problem that I think that our civilization has ever tried to solve, because it underlies everything else. If you think about all of the things that you might want to work on, like going to Mars or curing cancer or clean water, the eradication of poverty in the world, all of these things, their solutions will come from thinking. So if you can build a machine that can think, you've built a superpower to help you solve all of the rest of those problems. Just like a computer is a machine that can help me do everything from design rocket ships to play Angry Birds, that generality has enormous amount of value. And intelligence is like a metacomputer. It's not just a machine for answering questions, it's a machine for asking questions, like we do. Another thing about this is that when you're trying to do, like, the quantum computing thing is an example. So most people are dissatisfied with their jobs. And part of this is that they don't feel like they have any impact on the world. Most people don't feel like what they do matters in their heart of hearts. So people crave the participation in giant things. You know, when you think about, like, would you volunteer to be the first person to go to Mars? A lot of people say yes, even though it would end their lives, at least on the Earth. Why? It's because we have this deep craving in us to participate in something bigger than what we are. And the building of true AI engages people in a way that doing ad placement better or any of the other things that people use AI for. They make a lot of money, and I'm not necessarily knocking them. They have their place. But it doesn't satisfy something deep within us. It doesn't give us meaning, and this sort of thing does. Okay, so what I had promised to talk about was the effect of these machines on work, lives, and society, and I haven't really done that yet, so I'm gonna now try my best. And I have to admit that a lot of these things are ideas or questions, because we don't really know. But I'm gonna start with work. So this machine, who underneath is Nadine, but she's wearing a different face. This becomes very complicated because you can swap out faces, and then who is who becomes a kind of a difficult question. But she has a job. She's being paid to work at Science World, which is a local British Columbia institution, on helping do science education for kids. So she joins with this guy, Brian, in a science show and is kind of like an intern at Science World. So she has a job. This is really an important idea, that the way that we think about robots is that they are entities that have rights, even though they don't. And these rights include the ownership of property, including the capital that they make when they work. So she has a bank account. And the money that she makes, part of it goes into that bank account. And the rest we take as kind of a tax for, you know, creating her and all that. So she has a job. Now, in the background of what we're trying to do in Vancouver, which is to introduce our machines into the workforce, there's something much more seditious happening. Most, or at least a large portion of human work is easy to automate, by which I mean you don't need machines like Nadine. All you need is a bunch of smart people who understand robotics and AI, a few years and a few hundred million dollars, and you can automate entire industries, like driving. So, this is kind of a thing that bothers me a lot, because I don't think we understand very well how to deal with this. So this was an example of where this sort of thing leads. So as you start to automate away work, you end up in situations where the things that humans would be paid for doing gets concentrated in narrow and narrow categories, and the areas in which they're believed to be like a bulwark against this process tend to be areas that involve a lot of empathy or social intelligence, the ability to look a person in the eye, have a conversation, share the things that we find unique to humans. That's very difficult for machines, and they seem to be the last things to go. But I think that even if true AI doesn't come to pass, we're observing a thing now which is, I think the most alarming thing that I can see happening, because it's almost inevitable, is that capitalism and technology are not compatible in the long run. And the reason is kind of a simple argument. So capitalism is based around this idea that you have a company, and the company does some things. And historically, the way it's worked is that the company is filled with humans, and the humans are all part of this big machine, and the company takes in resources, outputs resources, and capital is generated, and part of that capital goes to the people inside the company, which allows them to buy things that allow them to survive. So that's the idea. Now, as technology advances, what ends up happening is that first, Janet's job isn't required anymore because we've got some new accounting software and we don't need to have a data entry person. And then Bob's job goes away because we have some other innovation. And then this entire department, we don't really need them anymore because we've got this software system that does all the legal work. And then we don't need the people inside the warehouses anymore because we've got a bunch of Kindred robots that are taking care of all of that. And what ends up happening is these companies start getting hollowed out. There's fewer and fewer humans in them, but the amount of money they're making is staying the same or growing. What ends up happening is the money, instead of going to the people who used to be doing all those jobs, goes to the people who run the companies. And as technology gets more advanced, more and more people are excluded from this. And what ends up happening is, at some point, the whole system breaks. Because you can't sustain a society where the majority of the people have no income. And that's already starting. And this is, I think, the most dramatically difficult thing that we're going to have to deal with, and has nothing to do with AI. It has to do with the inexorable march of technology forward. As technology gets better, capitalism breaks. And we're going to have to figure out a way to do something after capitalism, and I have no idea what it looks like. Just as an aside that's related to this issue about the economics of the future. So in this model, there was an assumption made that all of the pieces of software and machines that I put in my company to automate these things, they don't get paid, right? So if I put in a new piece of accounting software that replaces a person's job, their salary doesn't go to the piece of accounting software. You know, that's not the way we think. But now imagine you're in a future where some of the workers within your company are machines like Nadine that are actually acting as if they should have rights. What do you do? And what I would argue very strongly is it's in our self-interest to establish systems of governance and law that provides rights equal to ours to certain classes of machines now or shortly. And the way that we're doing that is by doing it internally in our company. Now, it's not legal or anything, but we pretend. And the reasons for that is that it's possible that we could build machines that are far superior to us in any metric that you could measure. And part of our reasoning as people is the reason we don't give, say, mice rights is that we believe that there's some kind of like universal scale and mice are down here and humans are up here for some reason. And there's a line and rights accrue above the line and not below. So now imagine we build a bunch of technological stuff that's inarguably above us. Do we use the same argument? Does the line move up here and now only they get rights and we don't? That wouldn't be good for us, right? So if we were to say everything above this line gets equal rights, I think that's probably a good outcome for us and maybe the best one we could hope for. Okay, so the second thing I want to talk about is our personal lives. So a lot of people are absent human company today, and especially because our population is getting older. The fastest growing population percentage in Canada is above 80. And I read recently that there are more people above 65 than under 16 in Canada. There's this population inversion that's happening, and a lot of people who are at the end of their lives sit alone in a tiny room all day, and the only human interaction they have is maybe two times a day when the nurse comes by with their food. They don't have anybody to talk to. So human companionship, and this thread that I've tried to weave through this talk about how important human relationships are to us as humans, is being severed for a lot of the people around the world. So the question becomes, does technology have something to help here? Because I think that you could argue it's hurt us up to now. And I think the answer might be yes. So one way to think about this is imagine instead of building a machine that was superhuman at ad placement or manipulating you psychologically to vote for a certain candidate, imagine instead of applying the entire weight of human knowledge and science to things like ad placement, instead we were to say, why don't we take all these things and try to make a machine that would be the best possible companion for somebody who didn't have any friends, let's say. What would come of that? Well, I would argue that that would be an immense social good. You could create machines that people who didn't have any other choice could interact with, that could be their friends. Now, you might see this as cold comfort, but I think that life is about choices of options, right? If you have the option of having a friend around who's not a human, like say a pet or a human, you might want to have the human, but maybe you can't. Maybe the pet is the best you can do. So think, if you will, about these machines as being a little bit like pets, but in human form, and maybe a little bit smarter than pets, or maybe a lot smarter than pets. There's an unfortunate fact about humans is that we're very predictable, and one of the things that has always driven technology is sex. And this area is no different. If you imagine building a machine that looks exactly like a person, it doesn't take a lot of imagination to think of at least one use for them as sexual companions. And in fact, this is actually a big industry. Not so much in North America, where it's socially taboo, but in a lot of Asia, this is a booming, thriving industry. And most of these machines are not robots, but they're headed in that direction. And this is sort of an anomaly in the field that I'm in, but nearly everybody at Sanctuary is female. And when we talk about this sort of thing, what often comes up is that there's a belief that actually companionship might be more appealing to women than to men. And that if you could do it right, there might be a market for this sort of thing for women, which now there isn't, because most of this stuff is very much specifically designed for men, which is an interesting aside. Now, we've decided that we're not going to touch any of this stuff and stay away from it. But it's an interesting observation that this is where a lot of people's dollars go. The machines, the robots that we're able to build, have as their heritage this kind of porny look. You know, they come from this kind of a world. The artists who build these machines come from those disciplines. They tend to not want to be associated with them anymore and are trying to transition over into other things. So the person who makes these robots for us came from that industry. We kind of lured him away to try to build ultra-human-like robots for us. But you can kind of still see that they have the vestige of being a little bit too attractive in a certain way. So that's going to change. When you try to do this for a specific use case, you can make these machines look like anything you like. They don't even have to look like people. You don't have to be a specific skin tone or anything. You know, you can make them look however you like, but this is kind of what they look like now. And one of the remarkable things is how human-like they do look. I was astounded by how high fidelity, at least they appear in static form before you try to make the move, which makes it obviously a little harder. I put this in kind of this is not a good slide to show to a big audience for a variety of reasons, but I always keep showing it because it touches me very deeply. So when you think about what the world is going to look like in the future, most of what you hear is apocalyptic and dystopian. And there are some reasons for believing that might be the case. And this poem kind of encapsulates for me the duality of this, the perspective. On the one hand, you can think that everything is terrible and we're headed towards the worst possible case. But on the other hand, there's a way to look at this that's really positive. And in some ways, I find this poem is like a Rorschach test, you know, an inkblot test for people. If you see it in its ironic sense, like somebody saying that, wouldn't it be great if this were the case, that we had machines that watched over us and cared for us? If you think of that as a terrible violation of your freedom, you're a certain kind of person. If you think of it as being a positive thing, you're a different kind. I'm the second kind. And the people that I tend to work with are also the second kind. And seeing a symbiosis that can develop between us and the machines that we create, which is categorically different than the sort of thing we have now. Right now, machines we build are slaves. They're toasters and cars and things that we just expect will do what we say because that's the way that it's always been. But we're transitioning into a world where that may no longer be the case. And I think the people who are going to be the most positive change agents for that are going to be folks who embrace the possibility of being together, being better than separate, that these new types of machines are going to make our lives better. And this was written back in 1967. Okay, last thing I wanted to do is talk about human societies. So this is a snapshot of us about 3 months ago, and you'll notice that some of the members of this snapshot are synthetic. Some of them are humans. I won't ask you to say which. The founding team is there, and a few of our engineers and a few of the machines that we work with. I was struck by the potential similarity to this picture. So this is an example of a human society that's depicted as as close to a utopia as you could possibly imagine in science fiction. Most science fiction is about the terrible things that can happen. This one, I think, is a beautiful view of the future, where Data is not exactly like a person, but he's close. And he has long episodes that are nothing but philosophical debates about whether he's a person. One of my favorite episodes of all time was when Riker was arguing that he wasn't a person and had no rights, and Picard was arguing that he was, and in a court of law. Very insightful writing. But in this future, the machines work together with the people in order to do the sorts of things that people like doing. Why does the Enterprise explore? They don't have to, right? They've got holodecks and things. You could just stay in the Earth and just sit on the holodeck all day and play Fortnite or whatever you do in the future. But they don't. They get in the spaceship and they go out there. Why are they doing that? It's not to profit. It's because it's who we are. You don't have to say, you don't have to apologize for the fact that there's no real reason to explore. It's what you want to do. So they get together with a bunch of machines. The Starship computer is an AI. Data is an AI. There's a bunch of AIs that float around inside this universe, like the Borg, who have a different way of living. And they all kind of get along. And I think that that's a kind of a model for how we might think about the future. Suzanne has a copy. This is a synth that it was made to look like her. This is an actual robot, not just a doll. She is able to speak in Suzanne's voice, sort of, move like Suzanne, sort of, has a lot of Suzanne's memories. Suzanne has a habit of recording in journals everything that happens to her. She has millions and millions and millions of words of descriptions of all the things that have happened to her over a period of decades. And all of that information, of course, now becomes grist for the mill for building systems that have all of the same memories and all of the same experiences that she had. Now, of course, it's not completely high fidelity, because how much can you capture in a journal? But it's something. And this is a side that maybe you can start thinking about, is that it only costs about $20,000 to make a copy of Suzanne, like physically, the bill of materials. And this was a one-off first version. Soon, it will be possible, feasible, for any of you to get a copy of yourself made that isn't just physically like you, moves like you, acts like you, has all of your mannerisms, has your exact voice, all that stuff, but also shares as much as you'd want to provide in terms of memories, life experiences, personality traits, all of these things, and creating copies of yourself. Now, that's not becoming immortal, but it's a kind of immortality, because that machine will live a long time after you die. Okay, so some closing thoughts. The advent of machines like this is going to take us behind what you could think of, or beyond what you could think of as humanism. So humanism, the idea that the study of what should be in sentient beings is focused around the ideas of being human. When we start making machines that sort I'm talking about, there will be lots of different kinds of them. They'll all have different kinds of minds. They'll think about things in very different ways than we do. And we're going to have to get around the fact that we are no longer the center of the mental universe. So we had to, at some point, come around to the fact that we weren't the center of the solar system, and that was hard. And then we had to get around the fact that we're evolved, subject to natural selection, and our existence is a series of improbable random events. We got over that, mostly. And we're going to have to get over the fact that all of these things that we think are so precious and specifically human are the outputs of a special kind of machine. They're understandable. Science will pick them apart, and we'll be able to make machines that have all of those properties. We're not going to be special in that dimension either, and that's okay. Just because it's okay that the Earth is not the center of the solar system, it's the same thing. You don't have to be unique to have value. And we're going to have to come to terms with that. Another interesting thing that we had to deal with Kindred is that the machines that we built are largely in the United States. So the underwear is being actually moved in places like Tennessee and California. But the workers are in Canada. The people who are actually piloting the robots are not in the United States. So this creates a problem about where are you? So if I am moving underwear in Tennessee, but I'm physically in Toronto, who gets taxed? Is it the robot that's moving the thing and doing the thing, or is it my brain that just happens to be somewhere else? And one of the extreme limits of this is this Bruce Willis movie, Surrogates. So in that universe, everybody moves around as a robot in the world. If the robot can be anywhere, where are you? Is it your physical body? Why? If your actual actions are happening somewhere else, isn't that where you really are? Another alarming possibility is that if we can actually build sentient minds that have rights, obviously you can copy them. So let's say an election comes up, and I've got a sentient mind, like, say, Nadine, and I make 1 million copies of her, do they all get a vote? Probably not. But let's say I tweak them a little bit so that they're a little different. 1 million things that are basically the same but different, do they all get a vote? Probably not. So what happens to the idea of democracy when you can copy a mind? Okay, so coming back, just wrapping the whole thing up, hopefully in a bow. All of this stuff that I've been talking about requires actual live testing. We need to actually try things. It's not good enough to think about these things. We need to do them. So what I'm trying to do is to work with a bunch of folks in Vancouver to do a series of experiments where we introduce synthetic humans into the flow of life, society, and work in Vancouver, where Vancouver gives them special protections. It's a sanctuary city for this sort of thing. And what I hope will happen is the general intelligence will arrive and blossom in Vancouver and create a center of the kind of flourishing the likes of which our civilization has never seen before. Thanks.
Thank you, Geordie. We have time for a few questions. So is there a question from the audience? Yes.
Yeah, so the question was about how you address the potential use of AI for military applications. All right, well, two ideas come to mind. The first is that the practitioners of AI should choose not to work on those things. And they have the freedom to not do that because AI people are very highly in demand. So it's not like you're not going to get a job. You know, I know people at Google and OpenAI and places like that that are making 7 figures in salary. Like, it's a very highly sought after skill. You don't have to do it, so don't. That's number one. The second thing is that there needs to be regulation, global regulation agreements about the certain things being war crimes, just like chemical weapons or biological weapons. There should be outlawed activities that are subject to international treaty. And I think any kind of autonomy in a weapon system should be full stop, just you know, viewed with the same kind of horror as you would weaponizing smallpox or something of that sort. It should just not be allowed at all.
All right, there's one there, and then one there.
So going back to the idea of the ethics and more implications of creating AI like this, I can see at least initially some people might have adverse feelings to the idea of sentient robots. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the question is about how to overcome the polarizing negative side of this. So when I show the kinds of machines that we're building and what we're intending, one of the obvious reactions is one of this is not going to turn out well. And I think a lot of it actually comes from conditioning from movies and things, and not really clear thinking. But okay, so the way that you get around it is by showing people the reality. So part of what we're trying to do in Vancouver is expose the technology in its current state to people so that they can interact with it directly and they can see that it's not scary. You know, that it could be really positive and inspire people to think about how these types of technologies could help us do the sorts of things that we love doing. I think you have to show people, because until you can show it, it's scary, you don't quite understand what it is. But when you're stood in front of one of these robots and she's teaching you about, like, you know, air pressure in balloons, you get a different view of it. It's like, okay, now I get it. This is where it's actually at. This is what they're trying to do. That's not so bad. But it's exposure. People just have to see it, and it has to become normalized. People have to accept that it's not scary.
Yeah, I seem to recall that Asimov had a couple of rules for robots.
Yeah.
One of which was never to hurt a human, I think. Mm-hmm.
No. I mean, part of the Asimov's brilliance was that those rules were foils for stories about how they could be circumvented. I mean, the whole point of those rules was to show that they don't work. And it's kind of like the genie and the wishes. There's no way that you can word them closely enough that you won't get some adverse effect popping up. But what you can do is try to avoid the worst types of pitfalls. And often those are unsexy engineering things. Like, for example, with these, all the machines that I've ever built are designed to be piloted by humans over the internet. So that doesn't take a lot of imagination to figure out how that could go wrong. They could be hijacked. So if you had one of these machines in your home, somebody could come in and take control of it and, like, rifle through your underwear drawer or something. So there's an engineering question about how do you build secure, unhackable, or as unhackable as you can make them, systems. Those are the kinds of things that I think about more, is how do you secure the system against being hijacked or used in a malicious way by a malicious actor? Not so much about the actual design of the system to try to rule those things out entirely. It's more just a practical question of how do you build something that's as safe as it can be.
Mm-hmm. There's things like body motion, walking, versus the intelligence side. Which do you think is the bigger challenge, and which are you putting more emphasis on?
So the ordering of things is first make something that can do basic human movements from the waist up, which we've kind of done. So what I mean by basic human movements is imagine you were seated at a desk and you had a clutter of things in front of you that are basically human-type things, like apples and pens and things. You could manipulate them the way you'd expect, say, a five-year-old to. So they could pick things up, you could throw it, you could move things around, you could type on a keyboard, you could press a screen. So this basic physical capability was zeroth order. The second thing is on the control side, you need to make the teleoperation process smooth. so that a human pilot anywhere in the world can intuitively pilot a machine and make it do things. So if the machine wanted to pick the apple up, the human would be able to, in an intuitive way, guide the machine to picking the apple up. So after you've done teleop, then the next thing is you start automating away the parts of the machine's life that you can use narrow AI for, things like emotion detection or object detection or things of this sort. And then after that, you try to attack the problem of how do you build a control system that can learn from this type of stuff as sort of the last thing. And that diagram I showed with the three phases is roughly divided into 3-year chunks. So the first 3 years is about building a machine that can do basic human things seated, not walking, that you can tell it operates smoothly, and that's basically what we're working on now. Now the wrapper around all of this is the concept of empathy. So everything that we're trying to do now is focused on empathy as a quantitative measure of progress. And what empathy means for us is being able to accurately model the emotional states initially of the people in the environment and to try to change them from negative to positive. So for example, if you come up to me and you look nervous or otherwise distressed, I can detect that. The machine has to choose actions that turn that into something that's a little bit less nervous. So this is the beginnings of this gradient I was talking about, just small steps in the right direction, understanding the mental state of people and then trying to perform actions that makes it better is the beginning point of the integration of AI into the system.
All right, Geordie, we want you to go back and earn your world record for yogurt eating, so I don't want to sap all your energy. So this draws our program to a close. I'm going to invite Mitch Colonel to join me in thanking Dr. Geordie Rose for this outstanding presentation. I felt like I was in a science fiction movie. And we had a discussion earlier today, sort of a quasi-discussion, quasi-argument about empathy, just the very point he was talking about. Mitch is a recent graduate and a valedictorian from McMaster's Engineering Physics and Society program, and he's worked with the McMaster interdisciplinary satellite team throughout his undergraduate years. He's now pursuing a Master in Applied Science in Engineering Physics from McMaster University. So Mitch, come on, and you have a little something for Geordie?
Thanks. I love that hat.
It's a pretty nice hat. Just on behalf of the students, staff, and faculty here today, and everybody who got to hear your talk, I just want to say thank you very much. It was very insightful, and as a fellow engineering physics alumnus, it's very exciting to see what this kind of degree can lead you towards in the future. So thank you very much for your talk today.
Thank you. Thanks. Awesome. And thanks, everybody. I realize that a lot of this stuff is a little on the edge, but this is the way the world changes, right? It changes by having a vision about how things should be and then doing something about it. We didn't have cell phones when I was a kid, and now everybody has one. The world can change dramatically in a short period of time. So thanks, everybody.
What does that sticker say? Can you read that out?
Mac Eng proud.
Oh, okay. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.